FOXP2 in family trees. Richard Dawkins was once asked what the best evidence for evolution was. You can hear his answer on YouTube, and there's a transcript of it made by Reddit, who are usually in his corner, so I trust they did a pretty good job, although you can judge for yourself because we're going to look at it. If you're looking for it there, it's about a third of the way down the page, and it's a long bunch of pages, so it'll take you a while. You would think it'd be towards the end, but it's not.
Out of all the evidence used to support the theory of evolution, what would you say is the strongest, most irrefutable single piece of evidence in support of the theory?
There's an enormous amount of evidence from all sorts of places, and it's hard to pick one strand which is more important than any other. There's fossils, there's the evidence from geographical distribution, there's the evidence from vestigial organs. I think, to me, perhaps the most compelling evidence is comparative evidence from modern animals, particularly biochemical comparative evidence, genetic, molecular evidence. If you take any set of animals and identify the same gene in different animals, and you really can do that because the letters of the DNA code, that's the same code in all animals, and you really can find a gene which is the same in, say, all mammals. For example, there's a gene called FOXP2, which is a couple of thousand letters long, and most of the letters are the same in any mammal, so you know it's the same gene. And then you go through and you literally count the number of genes, of a number of letters that are different. So in the case of FOXP2, if you count the number of letters that are different between humans and chimpanzees, it's only about 9. If you count the number of letters that are different in humans and mice, it's, I don't know, 30 or something like that, if you different between humans. Actually, frogs have them as well, and you find a couple of hundred that are different. So you can take any pair of animals you like, kangaroo and lion, horse and cat, human and rat, any pair of animals you like, and count the number of differences in the letters of a particular gene, and you plot it out, and you find that it forms a perfect branching hierarchy. It's a tree. And what else could that tree be but a family tree? And then you do the same thing for another gene. Having got the family tree for FOXP2, you then do the same thing for another gene, and another, and another. You get the same family tree. You also get the same family tree if you take genes that are no longer functional, that are just vestigial, they're not doing anything. It's like fragments of a document on your hard disk which are no longer being used. They're no longer on the directory, so you no longer see them. Again, you get the same family tree. This is overwhelmingly strong evidence. The only way you could get out of saying that that proves that evolution is true is by saying that the intelligent designer, God, deliberately set out to lie to us, deliberately set out to deceive us.
And then he moves on to another question, so that's why we stopped there. Well, let's look at that comment. And again, this is transcribed by Reddit. Question 7. Apparently somebody who calls himself or herself God of Thunder 44 asked it. Out of all the evidence used to support the theory of evolution, what would you say is the strongest, most irrefutable single piece of evidence in support of the theory? So you are looking for, this is at least for Dawkins, Exhibit A. There's an enormous amount of evidence from all sorts of places, and it's hard to pick one strand which is more important than any other. There's fossils, there's the evidence from geographical distribution, there's the evidence from vestigial organs. So I want you to notice the places that he says is the most obvious. I think to me perhaps the most compelling evidence is comparative evidence from modern animals, particularly biochemical comparative evidence, genetic, molecular evidence. So this is kind of his key case, surpassing fossils, surpassing vestigial organs, surpassing anything else. If you take any set of animals and identify the same gene in different animals, and you really can do that because the letters of DNA code are the same in all animals, and he's right about that. And you really can find a gene which is the same, or at least nearly the same, in, say, all mammals. For instance, there's a gene called FOXP2, which is a couple of thousand letters long, and most of the letters are the same in any mammal. So you know, actually, I can tell you that it's more like 20,000 plus, and why, in a bit, I'll say why. Most of the letters are the same in any mammal, so you know it's the same gene. And then you go through and you literally count the number of letters that are different. So in the case of FOXP2, if you count the letters that are different between humans and chimpanzees, it's only about 9. Keep that number in mind. If you count the number of letters that are different between humans and mice, it's, oh, I don't know, 30 or something like that, different from humans. Actually, frogs have them as well, and you can find a couple hundred that are different. So you can take any pair of animals you like, kangaroo and lion, horse and cat, human and rat, any pair of animals you like, and count the number of differences in the letters in any particular gene, and if you plot it out and you find it forms a perfect branching hierarchy. It's a tree, and what else could that tree be but a family tree? Well, it could be a resemblance tree. And since FOXP2 apparently is a gene that actually functions, you might expect that. In fact, somebody did that once with cars, Corvettes in particular, and showed how they gradually changed with time and how they could be arranged in. And of course, Corvettes are not a family tree. Their design tree. It's called Bayer's blunder. But you can do the same thing for another gene. Having got the gene for FOXP2, and you do the same thing for another gene and another, you get the same family tree. You also get the same family tree if you take genes that are no longer functioning, that are just vestigial. They're not doing anything. It's like fragments of a document on your hard disk that are no longer in use. They're no longer on the directory, so you no longer see them. Again, you get the same family tree. Now, if you read that, do you see any wiggle room? See any place where he says almost the same family tree? Or within the limits of error, the same family tree? Pretty dogmatic. This is overwhelmingly strong evidence. The only way you could get out of saying that that proves evolution is true is by saying that the intelligent designer, God, deliberately set out to lie to us, deliberately set out to deceive us.
Why could he call God a liar on that?
Well, because you see, God made it look like it was a family tree when it really wasn't. Well, this answer has been challenged by someone who calls himself Huge Next 2000. I'm not even sure if that's supposed to be pronounced. It's just what he puts down, you know. And you can find that on YouTube as well. And we're going to look at it. Now, I'm actually going to skip to the last two-thirds of it because the first third of it, he's just rereading Dawkins, and we just heard Dawkins and then read him as well. Let's see. Yes.
He says you get the same family tree. Well, let's take a look first at FOXP2. The FOXP2 gene tree in Ensemble Genome Browser is right here. We see pan troglodytes, which is chimpanzee, and right here. Showing more closely related to humans, which is what you might expect from an evolutionary perspective. But as you look over this, you would think that humans and chimps, the next would be gorilla. But instead, we have pongo, which is orangutan, and gorilla is way up here. And if you follow it back, you see that according to the FOXP2 gene tree, gorilla broke off before any of these other primates. to come over here with Microcebus murinus, which is a mouse lemur. Right here, Microcebus murinus, which is mouse lemur. So we already have a little bit of a problem. Let's take a look at FOXP1. FOXP1 has gorilla and pan troglodytes more closely related. So what you hear about chimps being more closely related to humans, well, not really quite sure. We're looking at a totally different family tree, and we have a different gene. What did Dawkins say? We should get the same family tree. But then we have FOXP1, and we have FOXP2, and we have two different trees. Should we look at another? FOXP3. Here we have Homo sapiens and gorilla more closely related. Next, Pongo, with the common ancestry for chimpanzee being nowhere. Wait, where is it? Where is it? Right here. With chimpanzee showing more closely being related to a squirrel. Wow, or a pig. Okay, so let's go back again. Let's look. Dawkins says you get the same family tree. But we get not only a different tree, but we get relationships here, unless somebody's gone back and said that pigs are now primates, or squirrels are primates. But here you've got pan troglodytes. Chimpanzees just sitting by himself. Sad. FOXP4. Well, here's a different tree entirely again. So what Dawkins says, you get the same family tree, and what the evidence says, we've looked at four different genes, including the one that he mentioned, and you get four different family trees. So what we have is Richard Dawkins saying one thing, and the evidence saying something entirely different. Thanks, that'll be all for today. Hope to talk to you very soon. Until then, God bless.
Somebody who calls himself Hugin X. All kinds of things pass by me, and occasionally I get interested enough to look at him. I can't tell you that this is part of a systematic searching of the literature.
Has anybody else done that research?
Well, you know, that's an interesting question. There's several questions. Why did Dawkins pick FOXP2 to begin with? I mean, well, chimpanzee is most closely related to human, but then gorilla is kind of out of place there. And are the trees really as divergent as Hugin X said? Is he using the program correctly? Can anyone check this out? Well, the answer to the latter question is, actually, there is a website. And early this week, I was able to look at it and confirm that, with the exception of FOXP3, where the chimpanzee had now disappeared from the list. Why it had disappeared from the list, I'm not sure. That my use of ensemble and his use of ensemble seems to give the same answers. Now, I wanted to show that to you. Unfortunately, well, first of all, let me back up and talk to you a little bit about FOXP2. What in the world is FOXP2, and why does anybody care? Well, FOXP2 is short for forkhead box protein 2. There are obviously at least four of them, and there's probably more. They're required for the proper development of speech and language in humans. And that's why it got its particular notoriety. It turns out there was a Pakistani English family where it was inherited as an autosomal dominant, which means if you had one normal gene and one defective gene, you had real difficulty with speech. But there were other effects, and they include decreased motor control of the face and mouth and decreased general intelligence. In other words, they not only were not very good at speaking, they were also not very good at, you know, math or whatever else. It influences the development of the lung and the gut. If you have both copies dead, not only does the brain not function properly, but the lung and the gut don't either. So, like most genes, it has more than one function. It regulates at least three other proteins, three other genes that produce proteins. In birds, if it's defective, they give incomplete and inaccurate song imitation. They can't learn the songs they're supposed to sing. It's involved in brain plasticity, the ability of the brain to kind of semi-rewire itself. Among other things, it has a polyglutamine tract, a zinc finger, and a leucine zipper, which are particular biochemical features that, among other things, happen to indicate that it tends to bind to DNA. And sure enough, it does bind DNA, and it binds certain parts of DNA more than others, and that's probably how it regulates the other three, and maybe more, genes that we know of. And before we move on to how do you check this, I'm just going to go back to his FOXP2. This is where he's pointing out the gorilla is up off way to the side. You'll notice you have human, you have chimpanzee, you have orangutan. If you go beyond here, you have, this is a bush baby, which is about, what, five, six steps up. There's another step here. And then you get to the branch that takes you off to gorilla and mouse lemur. Now, what I wanted to do is to show you, I double-checked to see whether it made sense or not. And as a matter of fact, when I was looking through the comments, somebody said, well, the chimpanzee gene that they were comparing it with was defective, and that's why the chimpanzee is way off way off base at FOXP3. Now, they didn't explain why the gorilla was off for FOXP2. But when I tried to do that yesterday, last night, and in fact this morning, I kept getting this Ajax error. I presume that that's a programming language and that somebody has messed it up. And so I could not use the gene tree function. I could not use the genomic alignment function. What I could do is do the sequence and blast it. So what you're going to get now is you're going to get to actually see the sequence. First, I'm going to introduce you to the gene for FOXP2. And you can see that here's an exon, and then there's an intron. And I'm just going to, then you get a little piece of an exon here, and then an intron. That is one humongous intron. And if you look over here, we have barely begun. There's more than a couple thousand letters in here. Let's just put it that way. I haven't noticed any repeat, but in order to do that, you'd have to select some of it and blast it and see if it did. We found another exon. And then more intron. Introns are pieces of the gene that are cut out and thrown away. Well, they're cut out and left to degrade. Sometimes they have genes of their own in there. Sometimes they block or facilitate the production of more of the protein. Sometimes they don't. We don't know what they do. Well, let's put it this way. When I went to blast FOXP3, the introns were not anywhere near this long. Why is FOXP2 this long? I don't know. And maybe if more scientists said that, we'd have a better world. Found a little piece of exon. And then another little piece of exon. And then this is another exon that's specific, apparently. Well, this is specific to some other protein, as far as I can tell. I haven't blasted it yet. You can see you can spend a lot of time working on this kind of stuff. Keep going down. Now I'm going to get down to near the bottom in just a bit. There's another exon. And all of this intron stuff is just not being used right now, at least not for protein coding. A couple more exons stuck close to each other. And again, this is another exon for something else. And what it's doing, I don't know. There's another exon for something else. Here's another exon. I'm going to roll through these. Exon just passed us on the way up. There's a bigger exon. There's a little exon, another little exon, and there's another exon. And part of how they know is because they can sequence the box protein itself, and they can say, well, there's, you know, it's got to be these amino acids, so they have to be coded for by these. So they know that it's there. Here's another exon for something else. Here's an exon for FOXP2. Aha, 3, 4. We're getting near the bottom. There's a big one here. And then there is basically, I think, the biggest one of all right here. And is there another one at the bottom here somewhere? Yes. Oh, I take it back. This may be the biggest one. Okay, so what I did, because you can take any of this and you can blast it, basically find out what you get. I took the biggest one, or at least the one at the end, which is, if not the biggest one, one of the two biggest ones, and blasted it. And here is what I got. First, I blasted it against human DNA. And this is rather reassuring. We find a match in chromosome 7. We are probably doing this right. And furthermore, 3,991 out of 3,991 match. So if you know, this is kind of the zero standard, so to speak. You know, can this program pick out? Well, it can pick it out in humans. And you can see it's a pretty long match, and it's 100%. Every single one of these has a line. There's no dashes in the top or the bottom. So that's a match. Okay, so then we'll look at chimpanzee. We found a pretty good match too. Now you'll see these 25, and I'm going to go through, well, actually, let's go back at the human and let's take a look at it, and you will notice that after we get done with the huge one that matched, you'll notice that we have 320, 40 to 365, 25 matches, actually 24 because one of those didn't match. And this is pretty nonspecific, it's just a bunch of T's. And here you can see that there's a couple gaps here and a couple gaps there, and yeah, well, let's put it this way. If you took a 16-bit stretch, the probability is that somewhere in the DNA it should match just by random processes. So finding a bunch of these really doesn't matter too much. Given that DNA is non-random, of course, I'm not surprised that we're finding, here's one that's 11 out of 11. Well, you kind of expect that. So anything under 30, you can probably toss it, unless it happens to be in a strategic spot. Okay, so, and that was human, and we know that where it's supposed to match, and you can see that there's little bitty matches after that. Now, if you look at this, let's see. A perfect match into 1, 2 different. And this one's interesting because that is a deletion, which means you should get a frame shift out of it, right? Fascinating. Keep on going here. Let's see that. So there's two differences, and of course this is going to give you a whole shift. Maybe there's an error in the in what's put up there. Makes you wonder. This is where. We'll kind of scroll through that. 3, 4, 5, 6. Seven here, and we may be missing one on our way through. 8, 9, 10. That's 10 on that intron alone, or on that exon alone. Now let's go back up there and look at it and see how many differences they found. They found 13. 3980 to 3993. We probably missed one or two. But that's 13 in that one spot, which is a little more than the 8 or 9 that we were talking about earlier. And this is only one exon of that whole gene. So somebody's fudging it a little bit. What did somebody say last week, that 85.3% of all statistics are pulled out on the spot?
What's the accuracy of the machine that does all this?
Well, that's an interesting question. Just a minute, we have another question here. We might as well get started here on questions. There, I'll give that to you for now. And yes.
Yeah. How does this program work? Obviously, when they missed one and you had a shift, everything didn't go off. Do they adjust?
Well, that's an interesting question, and we're going to get to more of that answer in a little bit. Obviously, if it was doing everything exactly right, but then that's what you hope with the computer, is that it does it exactly the same way all the time, and everything gets exactly right. Well, what I found out was that when we did the blast for chimpanzee the first time I did it, it only caught about 2/3 of the match that was there, and then caught the rest of the match somewhere else. Why it's not giving you exact figures, I don't know. But you know, when you can't trust the computer, then it's rather interesting. Now, I added this gorilla here because otherwise you can't, the printout of the blast does not tell you which, what she compared with. Here's gorilla. And you can see that there's one that's really big, and there's another one that's a little bit smaller. And then there's all these 25 and under ones that probably don't count. In here, you have 3607 over 3628, which means that there are 21 mismatches. Now here's one that's kind of interesting. You see, here's an addition, an addition in the gorilla of two more A's out of this long string of A's, which means you have a frame shift. There was one that I looked at where you actually had a frame shift and then another frame shift, and between the two of them they kind of compensate for each other. And you got back on track, which is kind of interesting. Mm-hmm. Could this be an artifact of somebody's sequencing program? Well, it does raise that question, doesn't it? Now, notice that this starts at 368. Okay? So from 368, we go all the way down to 3991, which is, of course, the full thing. But here, this little piece here starts at 1 and goes to 362. So apparently between 362 and 368 there wasn't enough of a match. That's what, 5 bases? Now it tells you that this is 11257. 0632, and if you go back up to here and where this one starts, it's 11257 0636. So apparently those four were off enough that the computer said this must be a different protein. So you have to take some of this stuff with a grain of salt. Now you still got 99% matching with the gorilla. And if you go down here, you've got 99% matching here. But just those four apparently don't match. In order to do that, I would have to get the sequence, the actual sequence, and compare it. And unfortunately, right now, Ensemble is not working. Or at least was not working as of 8:15 or 8:30 this morning. So here we have orangutan, and we have 7554 versus a bunch of the little ones. And this is kind of interesting. Here we have 5 that are shifted, and then 4 that are shifted in the lower one. So all of a sudden, this stuff all gets scrambled around. Although, to be fair, if you'll notice that this is all TTTTT, so that would be phenylalanine, if I remember correctly. Well, actually, that would be poly-U, so it would have to be the reverse of that. I think it, anyway, depending on which way it's being read. But this would be all the same amino acid, so even though you shift it, it doesn't matter. But apparently it shifts forward 5 and backwards 1, which is almost good enough to shift you back to the original reading frame, but not quite. I'm wondering, again, if because of all of this repeated stuff, if there is a if there is something that when they were doing the actual material, it turned out that they miscounted, because this is again in front of a string of A's, and there's just four extra A's. Could they make four mistakes at once, or is that just one mistake and you shift it one whole amino acid?
You know, I could care less on this. Where did the FOXP2 come from? That's kind of the egg, isn't it?
It's part of chromosome 7.
What's that?
No, it's
who created it?
Well,
or where did, you know, well, where did it start? Did it just...
You have two hypotheses. One of them is that it just kind of cobbled itself together somehow. Probably inherited from FOXP1, in which case, where did FOXP1 come from? Or maybe FOXP1 came from FOXP2, in which case, where did the original come from? How do you get all of that complicated stuff?
That's my question.
And the answer is, I don't think they have really a good answer for that. But they have ignored that question for so long that it no longer bothers them.
Do they have to ignore the second law of thermodynamics then too?
Well, what they do is that they deny that it applies to this particular problem. That's what they do. And the thing I found fascinating is, I mean, you know, I could count more errors than in that one exon than he said existed in the entire protein. Now, I suppose he could be lying. I suppose he could be misremembering. I suppose he could have been told by somebody who was told by somebody who was told by somebody, and as it got told, it got better. But at this point, I guess if Richard Dawkins says the sky is blue, I'm going to look outside to check to be sure. And really, that's the way it should be in science anyway, because nobody is really an authority in science. The authority is the data you get, which is why giving wrong data is the worst crime, and it's rapidly followed by not telling people what the right data is. So let's go to, Bush baby is particularly interesting. Here is 3462 to 3567. And if you look at the next one, this is 3569. So this is one that's separated by only one amino acid in the blast. And if you look at the end of this is 13186978, and this is 13186975. So what's happened is that there's an overlap there, and apparently that's enough for the computer to not recognize that this is all one long sequence that just needs a few extra lines in its amino acid to fit it. Now, where does it draw that line? I don't know. That's somewhere in the code for BLAST. Maybe anything above 6. I don't, you know. But obviously here it's treating it differently from what it's treated some of the other ones. So if you go back up here to Bush baby, you'll notice that there's a 1873, 1277, there's a whole bunch of them that match quite a few. And then after we've gotten through all of that stuff, now we get into the 3624 stuff that doesn't mean too much. And last but not least, our friendly mouse lemur. And here again, we have it all separated into several things, and you're going to have to, in order to do this right, you're going to have to figure out which ones really match, because BLAST won't tell you everything. But you can see that even at the mouse lemur, you're looking at 98%, which is pretty close. Now, let's put those down and open up our Now, what do I make of all this? Well, I think this is one more illustration that if you really wish to really know the truth, you must do your own research. And that unfortunately goes for both sides, because one of the things that I found out in the comments to the video, the second video by Hugenix 2000, what is that Hugenix 2000 had had claimed that chimpanzees were way off in FOXP3, and apparently when he was looking at it, it looked that way. Well, it turns out that the chimpanzee dream that was in an ensemble for that particular area had been truncated somehow, and that there is actually a full gene, and when the full gene is put there, it comes to a more close to what an evolution would call a normal distribution. It still doesn't explain what happened to the gorilla in FOXP2. When I went to BLAST it, I was going to originally try, I told you I tried to find it and the chimpanzee had disappeared from the list. When I went back to BLAST it, it is true that the chimpanzee record that was there no longer blasted with the ensemble stuff. So apparently there's some more chimpanzee that has not been recorded. So if you see people that say, we know the entire genome, well, you know, the truth of the matter is we really don't. We know most of it. And even then, our no is a relative, we have reasonable confidence in most of it. But you don't really know for sure. And that's something that any scientist that tries to tell you that they know what's best for you needs to be careful, because it ain't necessarily so. And the thing I'd like to point out is it's most likely to be worse, this problem, whether you have to check it out, precisely where the theological implications are the strongest. Because those are the points where Dawkins won't check to be sure. He'll pull the numbers out of wherever he thought they were. There are also the point at which Hugenix 2000 is most likely to say, see, the chimpanzee. And it's one of the reasons why I think we need to be really careful about too much snark. As I would say, always make your words as sweet as possible. It helps when you have to eat them later. Adventists have always said that we have to do our own work about the Bible, right? You have to study it for yourself. Well, it turns out you have to do that about science too. That's kind of frustrating, but that's my opinion. Now it's your turn. Yes?
We need to keep in mind Dawkins, in one way, has a point. I don't want to endorse him too much here. But he does have a point in that the similarities were fairly high.
Yeah. And on the average, chimpanzee does group with gorilla and with human.
For him to say that God is out to deceive us, I think, is not what you would expect from normal, reasonable design. By this I mean, why should not the chimpanzee be closer to man than to a jellyfish?
Structurally, they look that way. You kind of expect, even if they were designed that way.
If two organisms are similar, you do expect some similarities. And it's just not just superficial.
Right.
You know, we don't put a 12-cylinder engine into a motorcycle. Why? Well, you know, a motorcycle is not an advanced vehicle like a racing car and so on. We see in this sequence that you have, well, it didn't go much of a sequence, but the tree that you get from these, this has been known for over half a century, not by DNA analysis, by amino acid analysis.
Yeah.
This has been worked out, and the real question is, if God has a system that works, why redesign it completely for a different organism? I would expect similarities in systems, and for advanced systems, I'd expect them to be more similar than comparing a simple organism with an advanced one.
Was it last week or the week before that we mentioned that sometimes the similarities are kind of crazy coming between bacteria and humans and...
In all of these, you find some crazy ones. There's no question about it. But in general, you do find some similarity. But I think this is what you'd expect from similarity of design, which you'd expect from a single designer. This is a strong case for monotheism in a ways.
Yeah.
We had one God doing this, and so we find some similarities there.
Yeah. Well, I think the other thing is that there are just enough differences to make you wonder about somebody using the same design in two entirely different areas. But there are also enough similarities to make you think that a lot of the design is similar. Now, if you're trying to explain this without design, the similarities help. Differences, not so much. But the one thing I would, if I were on that side, the one thing I would never do is say they're exactly the same tree. Or even they're the same tree without qualification, because statistically, you would expect that every once in a while a protein would be a little more similar in gorillas and humans than they would be in chimpanzees, in which case, for that particular protein, you're going to get a different tree. And so I would be careful and say, well, to within the same limits and so forth. The language, the same tree, is evangelistic language. It is not scientific.
Just to add to that picture a little bit about the similarities. When you're designing an advanced car, you might have an 8-speed transmission. When you're trying to design a cheap one, you'd have a 4-speed transmission. They both transmission. They have a lot of similar genes, but one is a little more advanced than the other. But just because you can find that similarity and you find other systems, like the computer system would be simpler in the simpler car than the other one, you have identical trees there, does not mean that one evolved from the other. It could be simply require an intelligent design of building simpler systems for simpler organisms, more complex systems for more complex organisms. You're going to get similar trees.
And perhaps tweaking them a little bit here so that one of them can accommodate a bolt on the upper and another one can accommodate the bolt a little bit lower because of the requirements of design. Yes.
To somebody else.
And then we have a couple of comments after that.
Okay. I was wondering how the evolutionary concept, how do they say that we got the two different sexes? How does something that complex originate to them? How does that, I've never understood how that could evolve.
Well,
even in animals.
I would have to say it's mostly hand waving, but it's hand waving that everybody does. And so it has gotten to where it's not noticed that it really is hand waving. So you're right. I mean, we're picking on the similarities when you're looking at just massive intelligent design for the protein itself, which is statistically beyond anything that our universe can produce. And if you invoke, you know, infinite universes to produce it, then basically you've turned science completely unfalsifiable. So, which means it's not useful. It can't make predictions. Whenever you have a theory that cannot be wrong, that is, it will not say that A will not happen, and therefore if A happens, the theory is wrong. If it can't say that for anything, then it can't be used for predictions either, because it never says that we should expect B instead of A. And the falsifiability and predictive value are the two sides, opposite sides of the same coin. It can't have one without the other. And that's really part of why Popper made such a big deal about falsifiability. It's not that scientists run around looking for ways to falsify theories because they want to destroy all the false theories. It's not that at all. They really want the true theory that makes the right predictions. But if your theory doesn't make predictions, then it doesn't matter what the theory says. Just wait and see what happens and then fit it into the theory afterwards. And that's not science.
Well, it just seems to me that Dawkins is a creature of absurdities from reason, from his own reasoning. All first creatures, as we know them, have skin, hair, heart, lungs, some sort of breathing apparatus. We all share certain features, but there are a couple million known species where we can say this creature is different than that one. That seems very obvious. It doesn't seem to me like this speaks to that at all.
Well, I think what this data speaks to is be careful about saying
exactly.
Nothing really fits as well as it's being advertised, and that's a problem.
Yeah.
Comment back here, I think, and then one over there. And did you have your hand up? Okay. Tell you what, after him, we'll give it to you, and then we'll come back.
Me?
Yeah.
It seems to me as though that similarities can be not they're not just because of a common designer or common descent, but because of sort of common need. For example, hair and warm-bloodedness. You know, a good design of a warm-blooded animal would be able to retain its heat, and therefore it might want feathers or hair, you know, sort of thing. And not only in biologic systems, but, you know, like, say, for example, a jacket. Well, jackets that are thick tend to also have long sleeves, because the whole point of both features is to provide the same function, you know. So it seems to me as though that we would sort of expect there to be clustering of features and clustering of DNA that would tend to group things together. It doesn't necessarily mean a family tree. It means that functionally you'd want to have, if you have one feature, you're going to have an associated feature.
Right. Comment here.
You're picking up on what you said a few minutes ago, as well as what Dawkins said at the end about God being a deceiver. the dogmatism with which the naturalists put forth their worldview suggests that they are claiming that it is both complete and internally consistent. Complete because of the exclusivity with which they preach it, so that any statement, any proposition that can be discovered by science or anywhere else has to be somehow accommodated within that and can't be left hanging out for something like intelligent design or some other theory to grab it. Okay, but as Kurt Gödel has shown, to everyone's satisfaction, maybe except for Dawkins' satisfaction, that this kind of completeness and internal consistency is not even available in that paradigm of certainty, which is pure mathematics and logic. And if it's not available there, how can it possibly be available in something which is less rigorous than that?
Well, and I think you're right. Here's the thing. If people were content to say, well, you know, evolution explains a lot, maybe it explains all, but we don't know for sure, that would be one thing. If you were saying that, evolution explains everything and you need to accept it, otherwise you're guilty of child abuse for teaching your children this, that kind of thing. If you get that, that evangelistic impulse needs to go just a little further than the evidence. Wiedersheim, when he was listing all of the vestigial organs, was careful to say that some of them, like the thyroid, when they're gone, the animal behaves differently, so maybe they do have a function. You see, if you're describing organs that are well developed in one and obviously have a use in one animal, and are not well developed and don't have an obvious use in another animal, then you're open to saying, well, this one, maybe there is a use, we just don't know it yet. But in order to get that theological cutting, you have to have zero, absolute zero use. And so the dogmatism creeps in, not so much when people are trying to do the best explanation they can. Dogmatism creeps in when you start getting evangelical about it.
It seems like the discussion of similarities is non-productive because forensic science looks for similarities in order to convict someone of a particular crime or whatever. They look for similarities in order to say there's one person. And so it doesn't seem like this argument would be very worthwhile for either side to pursue to the end, because you can argue it either way with good rationale. It certainly does not prove the failure of a designer to have consistency between things. It would tend to point to a designer if there's consistency, and then it would also point to their tree. So it seems like either side cannot use this argument very effectively other than to counteract the other one's argument.
I think you're mostly right on that.
I thought it was interesting that Dawkins started out this thing by mentioning all organisms have the similar DNA code. There are, of course, a couple exceptions to this, but
One of them being that humans have, in common with most mammals and probably most birds and reptiles, have two different codes, one for the nucleus and the other one for the mitochondria.
Well, yeah, that whole area there. but no one, and there have been some attempts at this, no one has come up with any reasonable explanation as to how you start a code as complex as that, which would be useless until the whole thing was working for all the different 20 different amino acids.
Well, that, of course, is the argument of Eugene Koonin when he said you have to have multiple universes in order to make this work.
So, So that's one area that I thought was interesting. My start out with the code.
Well, that's the question he's raising, among others.
Exactly.
Basically the same question. Where do you get the FOXP2 to begin with?
Exactly.
I've wondered if Darwin would backtrack, if he knew of the molecular biology, if he would say, you know what, I'm going to eat my words here.
I very much doubt that Darwin would have gotten off, you know, in 1869. Was it 59 or 69, anyway?
59.
I wonder if Darwinism would have gotten off base if all we knew today was known then. I kind of doubt it.
He might have thought something similar, but A, he might have been more reticent to publish it, and B, more people would have been reticent to accept it, I think.
Of course, it wasn't Darwin that was wholly to blame in this. There was a great movement of scientific prowess, and science was so proud of its accomplishments and so on that the science felt it could go on by itself and leave God out of the picture.
Comment up here.
Darwin does say in his book Origin of the Species that if it can be shown that you have to have more than one thing at the same time to have something happen, then his theory is off, because his theory has to have sequential development. So he himself indicates that his theory is off, just with more knowledge.
Yeah, you have a point there. And the more interesting thing is we can say exactly how much that is. We can show that if you're dealing with point mutations, that each point mutation is by itself a single step. For bacteria, you can get past that. For the malaria parasite, we can show experimentally that you can get two steps at one time. But it takes a trillion malaria parasites per person, however many people have gotten infected with malaria for 40 years since, probably 50 years now, since the invention of chloroquine. To be able to metabolize chloroquine. That's only two amino acids that are really essential, and then other ones that can build on them after they're there. And the math was redone by some people trying to show that Michael Behe didn't know his head from a hole in the ground. And they said that instead of I've forgotten what he said. I think he said 2 billion years. It's only 167 million years, well, for humans. You know, at that point, it doesn't matter. So, the answer is yes. For larger animals that have slower reproductive cycles and lower populations than bacteria, two steps means two separate mutations. And you look at all of those things and how many mutations there are, and you ask yourself, well, how many mutations does it take to get from a creature that doesn't speak at all to a creature that does extremely well at speaking, that in fact congregates in buildings to talk to each other? You know, and it's there's too many changes.
It also seems that his little speech ends with a comment about God, which was not self-evident in any of his track of thinking. So if it's all about God, then you have to decide whether God exists or not. And that was Paul's argument. You know, if you believe God exists, then you can go down that track. If you don't believe God exists, you're never going to find him. And according to God, that's a foolish spot. Ellen White says in Fundamentals of Christian Education, Jesus was the great teacher. He could have made disclosures on the sciences that would have placed the discoveries of the greatest men in the background as utter littleness. But this was not his mission or his work. He came to seek and to save that which was lost, and he could not permit himself to be turned into his one object. He allowed nothing to divert him. This work he has given into our hands. Should we do it? So he could have put all this to rest 2,000 years ago.
Comment over here.
This is a little bit of a joke, but I mean, what gene does a mosquito have to have to make us more closely related to a mosquito than say a chimpanzee or a fish or something? I mean, it is getting absurd, interesting, but absurd to make those kind of conclusions.
If there was one thing that I wanted to say after reviewing this kind of data, it is, if somebody comes to you and says, I'm a scientist, and I know, and God does not exist, and I have a really good argument for it, you have to check everything they say, because they're going to be partly wrong.
Something that I picked up early on as I've studied some of the creation versus evolution topics over the years here and there, different classes, is that a lot of people miss and blur the line between history and science. By definition, science is something that we can repeatedly test.
Mm-hmm.
Gravity is the law of gravity. It happens every time. We can test it. We know lots about it. We can test things that we can do in the here and now. We can't test history. We can test evidence for or against things, but we can't prove one thing did or didn't happen.
You can't,
because we can't repeat it.
You can't go back and refight the Battle of Waterloo to find out who won.
Exactly. And so you back up and you look at, you know, how do we get here and things like that. Mm-hmm. There's no scientific proof one way or the other. A lot of people, I think, miss the definition difference between what's science and what's history. And don't get me wrong, we can use science to give us clues about what's happened, but you can never prove it one way or the other.
Well, as it turns out, as we've seen here, you be cautious about using the word proof in science. In fact, as somebody has mentioned here, the word proof in mathematics has to be used with a certain amount of caution, and science more than that, and history more than that. And historical science is kind of partway between history and science. And one of the things it assumes is that historical science assumes that there is no intelligent designer working on it. And if the question is there an intelligent designer, and the answer is yes, then finding out what the intentions of the intelligent designer are is far more important than finding out what nature can do without an intelligent designer in figuring out what happened in history. And making that jump is something that makes him very nervous. You may remember Lewontin's famous quote about how we cannot let a divine foot in the door. He follows that, and you don't usually see that quoted, is that if the divine foot gets in the door, that means that miracles can happen. That means that the natural order of things can be interrupted at any time. That's what they're afraid of. Well, see, I trust the divine foot because I think that if he does do things that are beyond the natural order, they're going to be even better for us.
A quote by, I believe it was Albert Einstein. He said, the most incomprehensible thing about the universe is its comprehensibility.
Anyway, come back next week. We will have some fun, I think. And pardon me?
Schweitzer?
I forgot. I put it in the email, and I don't want to say for sure.